1989, greatest year ever. So here I'm going to talk about a song called Mash Mash, bro.
Everybody knows what Toad Mash is, so I don't even have to go into details.
So in Toad Mash is, I would say, you should always try to learn new technologies that are your comfort zone. I live in a digital world. To me, everything is money and time. Money. I save money to my customers. I create solutions that save them money. Thousands of dollars. Tens of thousands of dollars. But time, I give them time. I can automate, I have automated process for them that go from months processing to mere hours. Everything is digital for me. IoTs to me were really interesting because this has a bridge between the physical and the digital world where we live. Everything is IoTs, and I wanted to get more into the IoTs. I'm going, wow, I want to get into that, but how do I get into it? Then Microsoft came out with something really cool. They came out with a Windows 10 IoT core. At that point, something went inside of me and go, that's pretty cool. I need to try that. I can actually install Windows 10, something that is familiar to me. I don't have to go and dust out the old PHP boots and start going, oh, what the heck was that command? I can actually see it. And everybody knows about Project Blinky, right? So they go, it's the first thing you do LEDs, and then like, oh, this is cool, look at the LEDs lighting up. Then you write some C# code, and you deploy it, and then you can see that you can move your mouse, you come down on the screen, and boom, there goes an LED light. Wow, that's pretty cool. And then I discovered tactile buttons. Tactile buttons, you wire them up, you press a button, and the application replies to you. Like, whoa, I'm an expert now. This is it. I am an expert. I can do all of this stuff. So now I'm ready. What is my big project? I want a big project. I want to do something really cool. I want to go and do something beyond the LED lights. I want to go and create a security camera. It's okay. I went out to Amazon, bought a little camera module, attached it to a Raspberry Pi Zero. Put some hot glue into that, put some plastic in the back of it, I'm done. I got it. I'm like, oh my god, this is the best thing ever on Raspberry Pi. Not a problem. So when I'm researching all of the security cameras, there's a lot of open source projects. One of the things that I found was MotionPi. And it's the one that allows you to say, oh, the frame's moving here, you detect the motion. And all of that is open source. But while I was looking into that, I found something called RetroPie. Anybody familiar with RetroPie? Oh yeah, you know where I'm going. Yeah. So RetroPie is an open source that allows you to run its emulators. So you can run emulators. You can have an emulator for the Apple TV, for the old Apple. You can have the Atari. You can even have the Game Boy. The old Game Boy, black and white color, has an emulator for that. You see that one of these? A long time. This is a big reveal. Just a little teaser, right? You can even do a Game Boy Advance. Wow. You can do Genesis. Who likes Sonic, right? Who doesn't like Sonic? But one of the biggest selling points to me was they actually have a main emulator. You guys remember the montage of putting quarters in there, unlimited number of quarters, and then trying to get the most? Just for the record, I was really, really good in playing in the arcade games. I'm actually kind of famous. If you look it up, I'm the famous AAA. That was me. That was me. You will see it everywhere. So I start finding out there's a lot of people doing portable units. You know, they come out with their own cases, they do all this stuff. It's all 3D printing cases. I don't want that 3D print. I have no idea what to do with that. But I've seen people creating all kinds of form factors depending on the device that they're using. So they come out with this. Now, this guy is really interesting. He created his own box that will fit the Raspberry Pi 1. So he measured everything and made sure that everything fit perfectly, so he didn't have to do any more filling inside of it. And then Adafruit said, hey, you know what? We have a model that's kind of like a kind of like an old Game Boy, but they had these buttons at the top. You guys seen the buttons at the top? And that does not look like this. Yeah. When you put it on there, it does not look like this. It didn't feel correct. And then I found a site that actually the guy went and did what I wanted all along, which is taking out the old game case, take all the parts out, got all the parts out, and reusing it, come out with your own thing. And you can see, he went and replaced the screen, put his own screen in there. And at that point, I was like, oh my gosh, this is it. This is what I'm going to cement the whole family name. I'm going to be famous beyond recognition here. My kids will be millionaires. I can create this, and I can be the king of everything. So, how could this be? Come on. You know, I already did a camera. I did all of that stuff. How could this be? Well, I started looking for some of the research and some of the guys. All that they're saying is, this is software, case, get some parts, and you just have to get a, you know, a Raspberry Pi Zero, which has been sold out at that point for months and months and months, but you know, once you get that, you'll be good to go. And I said, you know what? That's great. As a developer, I'm going to call it Project Game Boy. This is going to be named Fun. This is going to be great, a great thing. So I start looking for an old Game Boy. Where can I find an old Game Boy? And I'm thinking, how hard could it be? This is a 20-something year old. Came out in 1989. The first Game Boy came out in 1989. So it's a 20-year-old piece of plastic. $5, $10, I probably can find it at all the garage sale. I could just find it. I look everywhere. I went to eBay. $50, including shipping. Like, what the heck? $25 if it doesn't work. So I start hitting on all the used DVD places, every area that I could think of, nobody has it. Guess what I found it? I was a little crazy. I went all the way to a soccer tournament with my son, somebody in Dayton, and I said, well, we have about 2 hours in between. And I started searching, and I found a pawn shop. Let me go in there. I found this. $27 for this piece of glass. $27. Hey, but at least it works. So I was like, oh, yeah, do we have any games? No, that's extra. But you know what? I got my Game Boy. I got my Game Boy, and it works, and I'm thinking, I know, now I can do it. I can build it. And the first guy that I find is, okay, you open it up, you take the guts out of it, cut it. Get a Dremel and cut it. And what? I don't even own a Dremel. I don't even know how to use a Dremel. So, after some YouTube videos and stuff, I finally figured out how to use the Dremel. And I'm like, I don't want to cut it. It's so beautiful. So let's see what else can I find. Because after you cut it, then you have to go and solder some tape, and you have to rewire some of the controller so that you can put more stuff into it. I'm like, there's no way I can do any of this. Luckily for me, other folks went and created what is called a PCB. So they come out with their own board that all you gotta do is just put it in there and just put the wires into those little holes and voila. You don't have to do any of that ugly mess taken there. So I'm like, oh, sure. They go have another $15. 10 days later, I get my board. It doesn't fit. Everything is too big. It does not fit in the Game Boy. It only fits for their own stuff. So now I'm like, what am I going to do? Find a guy in Germany that had the same idea that I had. And he went and took the measurements out of the old Game Boy. And somehow he did a printing and he sent it to a manufacturer in China. And then they got it printed out there, sent it back to him.
GBA.
Yeah. Anyways, 3 weeks later, to admit it. It was about 23 bucks from Germany, plus shipping. I cannot watch. I don't have to cut my thing anymore. This is great. I am going. So talk about the case. I don't want to use this case. So I found a manufacturer in China. I sell the case for 10 bucks. I'm like, yeah, 10 bucks, that's good. All right, so 2 to 3 weeks delivery time. And it was closer to the 3 weeks than the 2 weeks. So I finally got my case. Yeah, I got a case. And the next thing I have to do on the case is learn to use a Dremel. I don't know if you guys ever use a Dremel, but apparently you are supposed to have a very steady hand. It's good to know that now.
It's a dog chew.
Yes, so none of you, somehow none of the buttons are like not correct. I went and ordered another one. Anyways, so I got my case, I got the holes down on the case, and I'm all set. I can talk about the screen. So the screen is supposed to be this way. Beautiful screen, it had the attachments, it had a controller, it had the wires in there. I can't find it everywhere. Everywhere I look for it is sold out. So I found somebody who said, hey, if you buy this, you can hack it. You can just break the thing apart, rip all the boards, and you get the screen. I'm like, all right, I did it. And look, it fit. Sort of. But I got my screen, I got my case. So now, let's talk about soldering. This is like my debugging in my world. When I debug, it's like, here's the board. I went and saw that it's a little tiny, it's called Teensy LT. So what this does is just looking at a keyboard. Hey, look at that. This is a nice soldering, look on the other side. It looks great, awesome, really good. Now, because that one was about this big, when I had to solder about this much, I didn't have enough space. And apparently somebody told me that they have been plastic, does not make good contacts. I spent a whole week cleaning out plastic and resoldering all of that stuff. I was just bad. Test, test, test. All right, so now I have everything connected. It's time to test it. I have my Game Boy. I connect it. I plug all the wires. I put the screen. Hey, look. Galaga. I can run Galaga. Yeah. I am invincible. I even can run now. This is Pac-Man. And then, I'm like, yes, this is it. So let me tell you about the Raspberry Pi Zero. Remember how I told you I was sold out? And remember, I don't know if I tell you, but I only have one. Somehow I have one. And I couldn't find any second one, so most of my stuff, I needed to put them all together into the case. And I went and started soldering to the Raspberry Pi with my hands. I'm going, oh my God, this is only this. I only have one. And it was a little bit weird when I started soldering, because now I only have one. Red figure factor. Does anybody know what is this? Does anybody know why is that for? Apparently, the Raspberry Pi does not like when it's too hot. How did I know that? How was I supposed to know that? That a Raspberry Pi would go, no, I don't like it, it's too hot. I'm still working on that one. Sorry if it melted. But I'm still working. This is my second refactoring. So if you guys want me to build one for you, I would say no. Thank you very much.